Have you ever wondered what an ESP8266 could do if it was not bound by Wi-Fi? A lot of people seek after this particular processor because it is a $2 processor that somehow, I don't know how many unicorns they had to kill, but they were able to make it talk Wi-Fi. Now, it's a full-fledged microcontroller though. It's got tons of stuff, peripherals, and it's got a core that's pretty zippy. It can be overclocked to 160 out of the factory. And that's pretty neat. I ended up doing a project with it a while ago with ESP USB, a little software USB stack for it, where I could write a bootloader. The bootloader lives on there, and if I can ever find anybody to write, you know, pick up the mantle from this project and start actually implementing it more seriously, then who knows, maybe the next round of ESP8266 dev boards might not have a little USB to serial bridge on them. At any rate, what happened a few days ago was I saw this, the Hackaday 1 kilobyte challenge, and it really got me interested. It was because I just recently worked on this ESP-USB thing, which is already too big, and it violates some of the rules, like using mask ROM. But it really had me thinking, surely the ESP8266 can be more than just this one-trick Wi-Fi pony. So I decided to go see how small could I get this thing to be to just make it wake up and start yippy-yapping to the various peripherals. And so thus, this project was born. ESP nosdk, or rather, nosdk8266. Sorry, I can't even remember the name of my own projects. Where I decided to take the guts of that ESP USB bootloader thing and shrink it as small as possible. So if all I need is for this little board to wake up and talk at its native 52 megahertz main processor core and just blink an LED, well, it takes 131 bytes. But you can tell very quickly that it can do a lot more without very much more overhead. I can do things like set up the faster clocks, like here, the normal clocks, the ones that you're used to, the 80 and 160 megahertz, which is all the processor was ever designed to do. And those work totally fine. Takes a little bit more space. But the crazy thing is, once I was there, because these programs are so small, here, let me show you. I can go here and I can just say reflash it. Boom! 1.9 seconds later and I've already put new code on this processor here. I can go edit my code. So this is right now using regular, so the regular mode, which does use ROM functions, which if you look at the 1 kilobyte challenge, you aren't allowed to use the mask ROM if you don't want it to count against you. So this is regular mode. There's a Pico mode I'll show you in a minute. But I can change the code here. Hello, I'm going to say world, exclamation points. And I can then run this program, reflash it, and recompile it, and look at that. In under 2 seconds, I've now taken my code, which I've just changed, and I'm testing it. This is just amazing. This is like totally the way everything should always work. None of this waiting for things to compile and flash and all of that. You know what? I think I'm going to call them DCMPs, development cycles per minute. And with a system like this, it's not hard to get up to around 6 or 7 DCMPs. It's just, or sorry, DCPMs. It's just totally doable that you can have that many development cycles per minute. At any rate, this does have access to the I2S bus even in Pico mode. So I told you I'd show you guys that. So Pico mode here is a mode where you can't really print things. But and you can, but printing things would violate the Hackaday rules because I use the ROM functions to print. But so for this here, I'm just going to blink the LED, and it's right there. It says 372. That's how many bytes it takes to make this code run. So under Pico here, this code here is only 372 bytes. How crazy is that? 372 bytes to make this thing wake up and initialize the I2S engine. It's the same subsystem. It's just this pin that you can control at a very high speed. It's like a shift register, and it has a clock. and I used it for my my ESP 8266 Ethernet adventure. And when I outputted to NTSC and some other guys using it to control stepper motors, and that peripheral is just an amazing peripheral. And you could only ever run it at 80 megahertz. At least I thought you could only ever run it at 80. But because these development cycles were so fast, I was able to just spend some time and just experiment with things. And I found out that by playing with the numbers that go into the PLL subsystem for the clock generator for the ESP, I could get that faster. I could get it a lot faster. So before, this peripheral bus was limited to 80 megahertz. Now the peripheral bus, I've gotten to go up to 173 megahertz. Now, to make things even crazier, when I had that running at 173, you can turn on the processor overclocking at 173. So it's already like 200%, over 200% faster, or whatever, two times the speed. Then you can go turn on this other bit, and it goes up to 346 megahertz. So right now, the ESP is running at 346 megahertz, and it's blinking this little LED. That's just insane. This little guy here, like, okay, before I thought it was an amazing processor, because, like, the whole Wi-Fi thing, if you ditch Wi-Fi, this thing can run circles around, like, $14, $15 microcontrollers. This thing is just insane. Like, there's going to be so many more projects, I'm sure, that are going to start using this because it's just so stupid powerful. Now, granted, 346 megahertz is probably voiding the warranty pretty hard. It's still something that really excited me. So this whole project right here, it's available, it's up on GitHub. You will need to get a copy of ESP OpenSDK, but I have instructions right there on how to get it and how to build for it. And you will want to modify the makefile, these couple lines here, to play around with whether or not you want a regular build with printf and everything, or a Pico build, which has, well, just about nothing, but it can make extremely small executables. By the way, if you do want to participate in the 1 kilobyte challenge, you're going to have to use the Pico thing. At any rate, I did a whole write-up here on GitHub, and this article will be going live. There's a Hackaday article that you can see in the description that will be going live with the video. So I hope you guys liked this video, and I hope you guys liked this article, and I hope you guys check this out and seriously consider using the ESP8266 for more than just Wi-Fi. I hope you guys liked it, and I can't wait to see what y'all do with this. Thanks!